Good day. I'm Norman Wildberger. Today I'm going to talk about a big gulf that exists between the way mathematics and mathematicians treat arithmetical problems and the way they treat geometrical problems. When it comes to arithmetical problems, we mostly all acknowledge that there are correct answers and that it's important to get those correct answers. And we don't allow any kind of approximation in general. So if I ask you what 6 times 7 is, I expect to hear 42, not 40 or approximately 45. However, in geometry, the situation currently, with our current technology, is completely different. And it's because we rely on angles. Last time I made the following strong claim. Let's call it Wildberger's claim. That using angles, it becomes almost impossible to solve concrete geometrical problems correctly. In other words, I claim that even professional mathematicians teaching at universities near you cannot solve the majority of natural geometrical problems correctly. They can solve these things approximately, but when it comes to actual completely correct answers, they fall down. It's not because they're not smart enough, it's because the technology that they're using, the conceptual framework, is not the right one. So let's talk about this through this example that I gave last time. We had a triangle ABC with sides 5, 7, and 4. And I said, all right, let's construct an angle bisector, so these two angles are equal, creating a point D on this side. And then let's go an angle 45 degrees from D to a point E on the other side. What is the distance between E and C? That's the challenge. It's a rather random triangle and a somewhat arbitrary problem. You can imagine making thousands of other problems that are variants like this or something in the same direction. Now, if you use the standard technology that people learn in high school and you work with angles, you may have obtained an answer like this, that the distance between E and C is equal to 4.935053.... And depending on how your calculator is set up or depending on what degree of accuracy you were using, you may have gotten fewer or more digits. But certainly you will have gotten to a certain point and then trailed off with the end with 3 dots. So let's mark this. Let's give it a mark. I like to mark mathematics out of 1. I like to give a mark of 1 if it's correct and a mark of 0 if it's not correct. Very black and white. Okay? So what mark am I going to give this? I'm sorry, but I'm going to give you 0 out of 1. Because in my view, this is not a correct answer. Why is it not correct? Well, I think you should all know by now. It's because of these 3 dots. What do these 3 dots exactly mean? There's an infinite amount of additional information that's off the page that this answer does not address. So it's only part of the answer, or it's an approximation to the answer. I remind you that if you want approximate answers to geometrical questions, you can always just say the answer is 0. Okay? So approximately any measurement is approximately 0. Are we going to give part marks to that kind of answer? No, we're not. And I'm not going to give part marks to this either. So what is the actual correct answer? Well, here's the correct answer that I worked out. The distance between E and C is this number right here. It's the square root of, here's a fraction with numerator 972261136 divided by 169167669. And then we subtract 228724160 divided by 169167669, all of that times root 6. That answer gets 1 out of 1 because it's correct, completely correct. And here is some more additional information about that picture. This additional information is in the framework of rational trigonometry. No angles, no distances, just spreads and quadrances. So it turns out to be rather interesting that these two spreads are 3/5 each. 24 over 49, so that's the spread there. Spread here is 384 over 1225. 45 degrees becomes a spread of 1/2. Some other values, spread there, the spread S given by this, the spread T here given by this. This quadrants, which is a square of distance, that quadrants is 640 over 81. This quadrants here is given by this more complicated expression. And more generally, I could compute pretty well anything you want about such a picture. And all of these numbers that you see here are exactly precise. There are no approximations whatsoever. So if we were dealing with a more complicated situation where this was just stage one of 4 or 5 or 10 stages, we would carry these exact answers along to generate further exact answers. And never are we going to compromise and replace an exact expression like this with a decimal approximation, because that would lose our correctness. Okay, so this is all in the framework of rational trigonometry. If you want to know a little bit more about this fascinating new development, there's an entire series of YouTube videos under Wild Trig, which I've posted, and I strongly suggest that you learn some rational trigonometry. The disadvantage of angles doesn't just extend to solving particular specialized problems like this. It also extends to even understanding really simple basic configurations that are accessible or should be accessible to public school and high school students. Let's have a look at an example of what I'm talking about. In this series, we've been working a lot with the grid plane. So here's a very simple example coming from the grid plane. We imagine each one of these lines is separated by, say, 1 unit. And I've chosen 3 points, A, B, and C, forming an integral triangle in this grid plane. This is a potentially natural and important object to study and to analyze completely. Unfortunately, with angles, it is very hard and cumbersome to pin down what's going on in a triangle like this. The sides are root 29, root 20, and root 45 if we measure in distance. If we measure in angles and radians, these angles alpha, beta, and gamma have the following approximate values. In fact, it turns out to be highly non-trivial to calculate these things. You have to know some trigonometry, and you need probably a calculator to calculate these things. I suspect that even a professional mathematician, to get this amount of information on this page here, with this initial data, without a calculator, would take a week of work. Paper and pencil, a professional mathematician, I think under a week of work, they would struggle to come up with these answers. If you're a professional mathematician, you can prove me wrong. Okay, in the standard framework of things, one of the advantages in working with angles is that the three angles of the triangle sum up to pi. So in other words, if we take these three approximate values, and of course we don't know what these tails are, we add them up, then alpha plus beta plus gamma is equal to this particular number, which we've all seen many times, 3.14159265.... which is the number pi. Well, we say it's the number pi, but we'd say that without actually saying what that pattern is that's represented by those three dots. So we're, of course, cheating, as we usually do. And this is usually considered to be a great advantage in the angle system, that angles add up linearly to a pi. I think it's quite dubious whether this is such an advantage. You can see the complexity here. This is far beyond what a public school or even high school student can really effectively understand completely. On the other hand, with rational trigonometry, the three spreads at these vertices can be calculated in a very elementary way. It takes a high school student 10 minutes to calculate these things. There's a spread at A, there's a spread at B, there's a spread at C. And they're rational numbers, reflecting the fact that we're working in a purely rational situation, which, I remind you once again, is the most natural and simple framework for doing geometry and arithmetic. Next time, we're going to talk about another aspect of the difficulty with angles, having to do with the circular transcendental functions. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.